Can I talk to you real quick? Anybody else from Birmingham has room in their car?
طيب الحمد لله
نعم just quickly inshallah 30 seconds
bismillah
okay بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه ما بعد I just very quickly brothers if I could just get your attention for just 30 seconds I asked the Sheikh Sheikh Ali's permission just when I was translating on the first day which was on Friday I realized that I made a mistake in a hadith And I only figured out that I made the mistake in the hadith this morning. So I just wanted to inform you about it in case any of you wrote it down. When I was translating, the sheikh didn't, when he was telling me about it, he didn't mention it was a hadith and I was just translating as he was going. And that's my fault because later on I went over the hadith and I made a mistake. So he said that the hadith was an incident that happened between Umar radiallahu anhu and between Shayba. And Shayba here, Shayba ibn Uthman. But I heard, as I heard it, I heard him say, as in like the Shayba, an older person. So I translated it as an older person. It wasn't an older person. The person that Umar was speaking to was Shayba ibn Uthman, who was one of the people, he was responsible for the keys of the Kaaba. So this morning when I was translating at Fajr, we came across the same hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari and I realized, ah, okay, when I translated that, I translated it. Probably I made a lot of translation mistakes, but that was one that came to the mind. And the end of the hadith is they are the two men who are taken as We take them as their guidance, i.e. the Prophet ﷺ and Abu Bakr. This was something yesterday that I realized I translated it incorrectly. I translated it as the conversation between Umar and an older man, and it wasn't. It was between Umar and a man called Shayba. So, small thing, but when I realized that, I thought it's worth to explain, inshallah. So I asked the Sheikh's permission, if he didn't mind, for me to just correct that, inshallah. Allahu alaykum.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Okay, brothers, alhamdulillah, we have Shaykh Ali with us here, Walillah alhamd, and his lecture today is about hadith versus fiqh approach when seeking a ruling. I'm sure, inshallah, he's going to explain what that's all about. You want to seek a ruling, do you go from a fiqh angle, or do you go from a hadith angle, or do we do both? Is there a harmonization here? Inshallah, this is his lecture, inshallah. We're going to break for Asr, and we're going to come back again, inshallah. الله يبارك فيك
خلاص هكذا قال يعني تفضل بمعنى شيخ الورق والورق
تفضل شيخ
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه واتبع هداه إلى يوم نلقاه أما بعد فموضوع الفقه والحديث والصلة بينهما موضوع مهم جدا وعدم إدراك معناه الصحيح يؤدي إلى خلل في التفكير وخلل في النتائج.
The Shaykh, after praising Allah and sending salutations, peace and blessings upon the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his family and his companions and all those who follow their guidance, he said this topic of fiqh and hadith and the connection between the two of them is a topic that if it's not understood properly, it leads to a deficiency in the results that you're going to get.
وقد جاءت الآيات الكريمة وحديث النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم متكاثرة في فضل الفقه والتفقه في الدين كما قال الله تعالى فلولا نفر من كل فرقة منهم طائفة ليتفقهوا في الدين ولينذروا قومهم إذا رجعوا إليهم والله والنبي عليه الصلاة والسلام يقول من يرد الله به خيرا يفقهه في الدين وعندما دعا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم للصحابي الجليل عبد الله بن عباس قال له اللهم فقهه في الدين وعلمه التأويل والتأويل هنا بمعنى التفسير فمصطلح الفقه مصطلح ابتداء هو موجود في نصوص القرآن الكريم وسنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. لكن ما معنى الفقه هذا الوارد ذكره في نصوص القرآن والسنة كما أشرنا إلى بعض من ذلك؟
So the Shaykh, he said that there are many ayat and ahadith in huge numbers that talk about the virtues of fiqh and tafaqquh. So the Shaykh is going to explain what those two mean, so I'm not going to overly translate them. But tafaqquh means to gain understanding. So the Shaykh, he mentioned the first ayah, that if not, that a group of you remain. And that is, as we mentioned, as the ayah was mentioned yesterday, that a group, when they go out to fight, a group of you remain in order to seek knowledge in the religion and to warn their people when they come back to them so that they may take heed. And the Shaykh, he mentioned the hadith that whoever Allah wants good for, he gives him fiqh in the religion. And he mentioned the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, that give him fiqh in the religion and teach him at ta'wil. And the Shaykh said the ta'wil here means teach him tafsir. And the Shaykh said this is a piece of terminology. It's a word or a term that is present in the texts of the Quran and the Sunnah, as the Shaykh has mentioned some of them. And he said, but the question here is, what is the meaning of fiqh in these texts that we have mentioned?
لأن الكثيرين يخلطون بين معنى الفقه الوارد في القرآن والسنة وبين معنى الفقه في الاصطلاح المتأخر عند الفقهاء، فيجعلون الفقه مجرد نصوص كأنها قوانين، كأنها تقنين، بينما الفقه المنصوص عليه في القرآن والسنة كما ذكرنا بعضا من أدلة ذلك هو العلم بمراد الله من عباده فيما يأمرهم به وينهاهم. العلم بمراد الله تبارك وتعالى من عباده، أي بما يطلبه الله تعالى من عباده فيما يأمرهم به أو ينهاهم عنه. هذا هو معنى الفقه الذي جاءت النصوص الشرعية التي ذكرنا بعضها تحض عليه وتأمر به.
So the Sheikh, he said that fiqh in the Qur'an, some people are confused, and what they do is they give it the technical meaning that is used today among the later scholars, the scholars who came much later. Fiqh has a very technical meaning. They use that technical meaning that the fuqaha use, and they carry or they understand the ahadith, the ayat that mention fiqh, to be the fiqh that we know today, as in the technical meaning of it, the science of it. And the Shaykh said it's as though they make the fiqh that is mentioned in these texts, these, you know, laws and issues that we study in fiqh. And the Shaykh, he said, whereas fiqh as it is mentioned in these texts, the meaning is to have knowledge of what Allah wants from His servants in those things which He commanded them to do and prohibited them from. This is the meaning of fiqh that the that is encouraged and that is praised within those texts.
فالفقه من حيث هو علم متكامل نتوصل من خلاله إلى معرفة مراد الرب تبارك وتعالى منا أمرا ونهيا، هو علم ينتج عن عدة علوم، ليس عن علم واحد فقط. يعني عندنا إنسان يعرف أو يحفظ القرآن الكريم ويحفظ السنة، لكنه لا يعرف لغة العرب ولا يعرف النصوص النبوية من الحديث الشريف ولا يعرف أصول الفقه وقواعده. هذا لا يمكن أن يكون فقيها حتى لو عرف القرآن والسنة، لأن القرآن والسنة جزء من العلوم التي تنتج بمجموعها قواعد التفقه وأصول التفقه والقدرة على التفقه. فهذه نقطة مهمة جدا، كثيرون للأسف الشديد لا يفهمونها، لأنهم يظنون أن العلوم تتجزأ. العلوم من حيث جملتها لا يمكن أن تتجزأ إلا في صور معينة، أما في الفقه فالفقه نتيجة متكاملة تثمرها المعرفة بالقرآن والسنة واللغة وأصول الفقه ومعرفة الحديث. بهذا يكون الفقيه وتكون القدرة على التفقه، ثم هذا درجات. لذلك الآن ليس المتفقه كلهم على درجة واحدة، بل ليس الفقهاء كلهم على درجة واحدة، بقدر ما يحصلون من هذه المعرفة بقدر ما يكونون على أعلى الدرجات أو ما هو أقل منها في هذا الباب الفقهي.
So the Sheikh, he said that fiqh is a complete and holistic knowledge through which we end up at the what our Lord wants from us in those things which He commands us to do and those things which He prohibits us from. And the Sheikh, he says, this comes from a number of sciences and not from a single sub-science. It comes from a number of sciences that go together. So he gave the example of a man who memorizes the Quran and some of the Sunnah, but he doesn't know anything about the language of the Arabs. He doesn't know anything about the foundations and the principles upon which rulings are built, or he doesn't know anything about the details of the hadith or the sunnah. And this person, is not possible that that person could become a faqih, a person of fiqh in the true sense of the word, because this is built upon understanding fundamental principles and foundations, and it's built upon this ability to understand. And some people, what they say is they have a false impression that Islamic knowledge as a whole can be taken totally independently of each other, the different sciences completely independently. The Sheikh said this doesn't happen except in certain very limited situations. So a person needs knowledge of the Quran, knowledge of the Sunnah, knowledge of the language, knowledge of Usool al-Fiqh, which are the fundamentals and foundational principles upon which rulings are taken, knowledge of the sciences of Hadith and so on. And therefore, the people who get this knowledge or who are learning this knowledge are of different levels, and they're not only a single level. Whether they are learners, the Sheikh said, even the mutafaqih is of different levels, and the fuqaha, the scholars of fiqh, are also of different levels according to how many of these or how much of these different types of knowledge they have mastered and they have access to.
وَمَنْ جَهِلَ هَذَا التَّأْصِيلِ في معرفة العلاقة بين العلوم التي ينتج منها الفقه الصحيح جعل الأمر في صراع بين الفقه والحديث على وجه الخصوص، فجعل الفقه شيئا والحديث شيئا آخر، أعني حديث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، وهذا غير مسلم به، لأن أصول جملة الفقه مبنية على الحديث، وبقدر ما يكون الفقيه ذا علم بالحديث وإدراك لمعانيه رواياته وألفاظه، بقدر ما يكون ذا معرفة بالفقه على قواعده وأصوله. أما ظن أن الفقه مجرد الاستنباط ومجرد الاجتهاد بالرأي ومجرد القياس أو الاستحسان من غير النصوص أو من غير ذكر النصوص، فهذا ظن فاسد، بل هذا قد يكون سببا لإخراج الفقه عن حقيقته الشرعية الوارد الحث عليه، كما ذكرنا في بعض النصوص من القرآن الكريم وسنة النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم.
The Sheikh, he said, whoever is ignorant of this fundamental concept in the connection between these things, this upon which the connection upon which real true fiqh comes, this person is a person who makes a battle or a fight between fiqh and hadith, and they make the two separate like that. And they make fiqh something and they make hadith something totally different that are at war with each other. And the Sheikh said the fundamental principles or the core upon which fiqh is based is upon the texts, i.e. the hadith. And the Shaykh, he said that according to someone's knowledge of the hadith, according to his knowledge of the riwayat, the chains of the hadith, and the wordings of the hadith, and so on, this is how much fiqh the person will have in terms of their... So what the Shaykh is saying here is, the more knowledge someone has about the riwayat, the chains of narration, the alfaz, the different wordings, the more knowledge, the stronger they're going to be in their principles of fiqh and their rulings which they take out from their fiqh. And the Shaykh said, anyone who thinks that fiqh is just about istinbat, it's about just taking things out, and it's just about a ra'i, it's just about opinions and ideas, or your best idea of what's going on, or it's just about looking at, you know, which the different issues like that, without going back to these texts, then this is a false concept. And it's something which could lead to fiqh actually completely being taken outside of its proper place. If a person only bases it upon just taking out rulings like that without referring back to those texts which underpin those rulings.
خلاصة ما تقدم أيها الإخوة في الله أن مبنى الفقه على القرآن والحديث أصالة، وأن العلوم المساعدة لإدراك معاني القرآن والحديث أصلان، الأصل الأول أصول الفقه وقواعده، والأصل الثاني اللغة العربية. إذن عندنا أصل وعندنا مساعد لهذا الأصل، الأصل القرآن والسنة، والمساعد قواعد الفقه والأصول إضافة إلى اللغة العربية. أي نقص في هذا المجموع المبارك يكون نقصا وخللا في الفقه والتفقه والفهم عن الله تعالى ورسوله. وبقدر ما تمتلئ القلوب والعقول فهما وإدراكا لهذه القواعد بجملتها، بقدر ما ينال العبد الفقه والقدرة عليه والاستطاعة على النظر والاستنباط والإفتاء بذلك.
The Shaykh, he said, the summary of what has been said is that fiqh is built upon the Quran and the Sunnah to begin with. And that there are supporting forms of knowledge which allow us to properly understand its meaning. And the Shaykh divided them into two. He said the first is Usool al-Fiqh and the Qawa'id, that is the science of fiqh, what we sometimes call the science of fiqh or the fundamentals of fiqh, and the rules and principles that come with that. And the second, the Shaykh, he said, is the Arabic language. So these two come together to support, as supporting sciences for the main science itself. And the Shaykh said that any deficiency in this blessed collection of knowledge, whether it is in the original science or the supporting sciences, is going to lead to a deficiency in fiqh, in understanding, and in acquiring knowledge. And so the Shaykh said, as the more that a person's mind can understand these, the more you take in, the more your intellect absorbs, the more fiqh you're going to have, the more you're going to be able to look at issues and weigh them up, the more you're going to be able to extract rulings, and the better you're going to be able to give fatawa.
هذه هي النظرة العامة الصحيحة في منهج أهل الحديث لدراسة الفقه والتفقه وتخريج المتفقه والفقهاء. لكن في المجتمع العلمي السائد في بعض المجتمعات هنالك خلل في فهم هذا المنهج وتصوره وإدراكه، وبالتالي تصدر إشاعات أو شبهات أو تصورات مغلوطة نحو منهج أهل الحديث المبني على القرآن والسنة كما قلنا، والذي فيه العلوم المساعدة لمعرفة أصول الفقه وقواعده واللغة العربية. الآن يرد شيء من هذه الإشكالات، طبعا هذه كما قلنا قواعد عامة، وإلا مثلا قبل ذكر الإشكالات هنالك يعني يجب على الفقيه والمتفقه أن يعرف أقوال العلماء صحيحها وصوابها وخطأها، حقها وباطلها، يعرف الإجماع والخلاف. لذلك قالوا من شروط المفتي الذي يتصدر لإفتاء الناس في الدين أن يكون عارفا بالإجماع والخلاف. بالإجماع حتى لا يدعي خلافا في مسألة أجمع عليها، وبالخلاف حتى لا يدعي خلافا فيه إجماع أو العكس. هذه نقطة مهمة ومهمة جدا. أما الشبهات فأهمها أن المخالفين لنا من المتعصبة وغيرهم يعلنون ويشيعون أن أهل الحديث يأخذون من الحديث مباشرة ولا يأخذون فقههم من كتب العلماء التي شرحت الأحاديث واستنبطت منها وبينت وجوه الاتفاق والافتراق والخلاف والإجماع فيها، وهذه فرية بلا مرية. ومن فعل ذلك مقتصرا على الحديث والنظر في كتب الحديث دون أن يكون له نظر في كتب الفقهاء وطرائق الاستنباط ووجوه الإجماع والخلاف فهو عندنا مخطئ خطأ كبيرا. فعلم الحديث وروايات الحديث ونصوص الحديث قد خدمها مئات العلماء والأئمة عبر هذه القرون المتطاولة من العلم والفقه في الدين.
The Sheikh, he said, this is the general concept which is correct and describes the methodology of Ahlul Hadith in the matter of fiqh and how we bring out or how we produce fuqaha and scholars of fiqh. But the Sheikh said, there is often in some places a misunderstanding or a deficiency in understanding this methodology and having a complete picture of it. And so there are shubuhat, misguided or mistaken concepts, there are false ideas, there are tasawwurat, ideas or imagine, people have these things they imagine regarding the manhaj of Ahlul Hadith, which the Shaykh reminded us again has those aspects of Usool al-Fiqh, the fundamentals of fiqh, as well as the language of the Arabs. And the Shaykh, he said, before we mention this, he spoke about before this, that this is a general principle. He said, even though what I've given you is a qa'ida amma, it's a general concept, otherwise we still have to say that everyone who wants to, or everyone who practices that science of fiqh and wants to be a person of understanding and wants to give verdicts, that person needs to know the aqwal of the ulama, the statements of the scholars. They need to know what was right and what was wrong. They need to know what was truthful and what was false. They need to know ijma', which is consensus, and khilaf, the areas where the scholars differed. And the Shaykh said, from the conditions of the mufti, is that the mufti has to know the things the scholars had consensus over and the things that the scholars differed over, so that he doesn't claim falsely there is consensus on something when it's a matter of disagreement, and he doesn't claim that there's disagreement about something where there's a matter of consensus. So the Shaykh then said, we're going to talk about the shubuhat now. So he said, the people who oppose us, from those people who are, they have ta'assub, they have this, you know, they stick to their way without, and they're stubborn in it. Those people, they say, Ahlul Hadith, you people take the knowledge from the Hadith directly. You don't refer to any books of explanation of Hadith. You don't refer to what the scholars say. You don't refer to anything around that. You just go to a Hadith and you just take what you want from it directly. And the Shaykh said, this is not something which is true. And he said, this is a firya, this is a lie and a transgression and a false statement. and it has no basis to it at all. He said that it's not possible for someone to go in without these things, without knowing the difference between the consensus and the areas of disagreement and so on. And he said it's not possible for someone to go into a hadith without knowing any of these things and without giving any consideration to what the scholars agreed and what they disagreed and what they said and their principles. It's not possible for someone to go into a hadith like that. And if he does that, he has made a huge mistake. He said, how many of the scholars, hundreds of scholars, have given service and have served this religion through explaining these hadith and commentating on these hadith? And so the Shaykh is saying that it's not from our methodology that we don't give attention or we ignore these things, and that is a huge mistake.
وهنا يبرز السؤال هل يجوز لطالب العلم أن يتفقه من الكتب الفقهية أم لا بد أن يكون تفقهه من كتب الحديث؟ ابتداء أجبنا عن القسم الأول وقلنا التفقه في كتب الحديث مباشرة دون الاستعانة بالشراح والمعلقين والمتفقهين والمستنبطين من كتب الحديث هذا خطأ، لابد من الاستعانة بهذه الكتب والمؤلفات والمصنفات حتى يكون النظر الفقهي في النصوص الحديثية صحيحا. أما الكتب الفقهية فهي نوعان بالجملة، نوعان. النوع الأول الكتب التي هي عبارة عن متون فقط، مسائل الفقه هكذا دون أدلة. والأمر الثاني أو النوع الثاني هو الكتب التي تأتي بنصوص القرآن والسنة وتستنبط منهما وتشرح لهما وتذكر الخلاف والإجماع في كتب الفقهاء. نحن لسنا ضد النوع الأول، لكننا نؤخره ليكون في المرتبة الثانية. أما النظر ابتداء فيكون في الكتب التي تذكر النصوص والأدلة وتذكر الاستنباط والإجماع والخلاف ثم الترجيح. لذلك نرى الحنفية يخالفون الشافعية، والشافعية يخالفون المالكية، والمالكية يخالفون الحنابلة، أو بأي طريقة من الطرق يخالف بعضهم بعضا. نحن لسنا ضد الخلاف، الخلاف موجود، والعقول متفاوتة والإدراكات متباينة، ولولا تفاوت العقول والإدراكات لما حصل الخلاف بين الفقهاء حتى الصحابة الآن. يعني معذرة، بعض إخواننا من أهل الحديث يظن أنه لابد أن تكون الأمة على قول واحد، هذا مستحيل. انظروا إلى كتاب مصنف ابن أبي شيبة، انظروا إلى كتاب مصنف عبد الرزاق الصنعاني، انظروا إلى كتاب سنن سعيد ابن منصور، انظروا إلى كتاب السنن الكبرى للإمام البيهقي. ستجدون بعد نصوص القرآن والسنة باب في قول الصحابة كذا، باب في من خالف ذلك من الصحابة، هذا موجود. لذلك أنا أنصح طلبة الفقه أن يقرأوا وأن يفهموا وأن يدققوا بقراءة كتاب رفع الملام عن الأئمة الأعلام لشيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية. رفع الملام يعني رفع اللوم، أي أن العلماء لا يلامون، لا يلام العلماء فيما افترقوا فيه واختلفوا فيه في كتب الفقه وفي النصوص، لكن أسباب اختلافهم أجملها شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية بعشرة أسباب. والحقيقة أن الدخول في هذه الأسباب العشرة وشرحها يعني سيطول بنا المقام جدا. لكن مثلا من الفقهاء من وصله حديث ولم يصل الفقيه الآخر فاختلف، من الفقهاء من وصله حديث ناسخ والآخر وصله الحديث المنسوخ فاختلفوا، من الفقهاء من استنبط وجها من وجوه اللغة من نص والآخر الفقيه الآخر استنبط وجها آخر فاختلفوا، وهكذا في عشرة أسباب مهمة تبين لك أهمية العلم وجمع فروعه وأصوله حتى يكون طالب العلم متفقها أو العالم فقيها على وجه الحق والحقيقة.
The Sheikh, he said, here there is a question. Is it allowed for a student of knowledge to take knowledge from the books of fiqh directly or from the books of hadith directly? He said, we've already answered with regard to the books of hadith that it's not allowed for him to take that without referring to the explanations, without referring to the rulings the scholars extracted from them, and so on, the istinbat. He said, this is a khata, this is a mistake. And the Sheikh, he mentioned, when is it that a person's approach to fiqh is valid? He said that he mentioned two types of books. He said that there are books of fiqh that are mutun, but they don't have any evidences in them. So we're talking about a book of fiqh here that doesn't have evidences from the Quran and the Sunnah in them. And the Sheikh said, we're not opposed to those books. We don't have any objection to those books. But we're going to delay those books to the second level, to the next, you know, the next stage, level two. The second kind of book that the Sheikh mentioned is the books which contain fiqh, they're fiqh books, and they contain texts from the Quran and the Sunnah. They contain some explanation. They contain some where the areas of disagreement and consensus are. They contain extracting the rulings from those texts. And they contain tarjih. The scholar says which one is the right answer. So the Sheikh said, these are the books that we're going to tell you you need to give attention to this at your first level, at level one. Those are the books that contain the Quran and the Sunnah, and they contain explanations and rulings, and they mention disagreements and agreements, and the Sheikh at the end makes tarjih. He tells you what is correct, or what he believes to be the correct opinion. And the Sheikh, he said, explaining that disagreements between, for example, the Hanafiya, they have a different opinion to the Shafi'iyya, different opinion to the Malikiyya, different opinion to the Hanabila, and all the different variations of that. The reason that this difference happened is because people's intellects are of different degrees and different levels, and the amount someone understands something differs from another person. And the Sheikh said, if it wasn't for this, there would never have been any disagreement in the first place. And the Sheikh said, even among the Sahaba, and he said, it's impossible that everyone agrees upon everything. So he recommended for you, for example, if you were to read from the Musannaf of Ibn Abi Shaybah, or you were to read from the same of the Musannaf Abdul Razzaq, or you were to read likewise this one of Sa'id ibn Mansur, or you were to read the book of al-Imam al-Bayhaqi, and so on, you would see that after mentioning their ahadith and their texts, they have chapters on the different opinions of the Sahaba on a particular issue. And that's why the Sheikh said, I advise the student of fiqh that they read a book which is called Raf'ul Malam, and this book is by Shaykhul Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala. And I don't know whether this book I suspect it has been translated into English, I'm not sure. But basically it talks about how there isn't blame, there's no loan, there's no blame upon the different scholars who differed on fiqh issues. And the Sheikh said that the Shaykhul Islam in this book, he mentions approximately 10 reasons why the scholars differed on these issues. And the Sheikh said, if we go into all 10 of them, this is going to take a very long time. However, just to give examples, one scholar, a hadith reached him, and the other scholar, that hadith never reached that scholar. He didn't know about that hadith. One scholar, a hadith reached him that was nasikh. That hadith abrogates what came before it. But the other scholar, he had the hadith that was mansukh. It was abrogated. So they both had a hadith, but one of them had a later hadith which overrules and abrogates the hadith that came before it. One of them took a linguistic approach to a particular text and took out a benefit based on the language of the Arabs. And the other one took a different approach to a particular text. And so on, the Sheikh said. So it's very important for the person who wants to gather knowledge, that person gathers between the furu' and the usul. They gather between the subsidiary things, the things which are not comprehensive principles but individual issues and individual details, as well as comprehensive principles. They bring all of those things together, the fundamentals as well as the subsidiary issues.
فالغفلة أو التغافل عن هذا البيان وعن هذا التأصيل في الائتلاف العلمي بين الفقه والحديث الذي سلكه أئمة العلم قديما وحديثا ولد أعني هذا التغافل أو الغفلة ولد ثغرة وفجوة بين العلم الحديثي والعلم الفقهي فنتج القول أن فلان محدث وليس بفقيه أو القول أن فلان فقيه وليس بمحدث ابتداء نعم يوجد من هو فقيه وليس بمحدث ويوجد من هو محدث وليس بفقيه ويوجد من هو فقيه محدث ومن هو محدث وفقيه لكن الأصل أن مادة الفقه هو الحديث بعد القرآن الكريم وبالتالي المحدث الأصل أن يكون فقيها والفقيه أن يكون محدثا لكن أكرر الغفلة عن هذا الأصل الواجب أوجدت هذه الفجوة بين العلوم من هنا صرنا نسمع من يقول مثلا على سبيل المثال الشيخ الألباني محدث وليس بفقيه مع أن هذه الكلمة نفسها كما نقل الإمام الذهبي عن الإمام ابن عقيل أبي الوفاء ابن عقيل الحنبلي أن هذه الكلمة نفسها قيلت في الإمام أحمد بن حنبل قالوا الإمام أحمد محدث وليس بفقيه وهذا غير صحيح هذا غير صحيح أنا أضرب على ذلك مثلين يسيرين الشيخ الألباني طبع له قريبا مجموع الأسئلة الفقهية التي وردت في أشرطته وتسجيلاته فبلغ عدد مجلداتها 18 مجلدا 18 مجلدا كلها فقه واستنباط ونظر وهذا يجوز وهذا لا يجوز هذا سنة وهذا بدعة الآن هل الشيخ الألباني أصاب أم أخطأ ما هي النسبة في صوابه أو خطأه هذه قضية أخرى يحاسب فيها الشيخ الألباني ويحاسب فيها أئمة الفقه جميعا الشيخ الألباني ليس هو فرد زمانه حتى يحاكم أو يحاسب محاسبة على غير ما يحاسب عليه العلماء قبله الشيخ الألباني عالم من العلماء مثله مثل غيره لكنه اجتهد كما اجتهد غيره في معرفة النصوص والمسائل والدلائل وله ترجيحات وآراء وتفردات واختيارات قد نوافقه في بعضها أو نخالفه في بعض الآخر هكذا هو العلم العلم اجتهاد خطأ وصواب العلم أجر وأجران العلم قبول للحق ورجوع إلى الحق فالإمام أحمد كان كذلك تماما وقد رد الإمام ابن عقيل فيما نقله الإمام الذهبي هذه الفرية وقال انظروا إلى مسائل أبناء الإمام أحمد كعبد الله وصالح وغيرهما وتلاميذ الإمام أحمد كإسحاق بن راهويه وابن هانئ وغيرهما كلها فقه مثل أشرطة مع الفارق عفوا الزماني والعلمي في المكان والمكانة والمنزلة بين الشيخ الألباني والإمام أحمد هذا موجود هذا هو الفقه ما ما ماذا تتصورون الفقه الذي تسلبونه عن هؤلاء العلماء ما هو هذا خيال في خيال إنما يريدون الطعن بالعلم والعلماء وأهل الحديث فابتدأوا بالطعن بالإمام أحمد وانتهوا إلى الطعن في الشيخ الألباني وهو طعن فاشل في صورتيه أولا وأخيرا
الشيخ said that the ignorance of this and a person not only being ignorant but causing themselves to be ignorant about this fundamental concept of the connection between these sciences led to a gap appearing between the knowledge of hadith and the knowledge of fiqh. And it led to statements that so-and-so is a faqih. He's a scholar of fiqh, but he's not a scholar of hadith. And so-and-so is a scholar of hadith, but he's not a scholar of fiqh. The Shaykh said, yes, it is possible for all of those combinations. It's possible that you can have a person of fiqh who's not a person of hadith, and a person of hadith who's not a person of fiqh, and a person who is both of them. But the Shaykh said the original, the asal, the basic concept is that the person of hadith should also be a person of fiqh, and the scholar of fiqh should also be a scholar of hadith, because the madda, the source from which fiqh is based, is the Quran and the hadith. The Shaykh said, I'm going to give you an example or two examples. He said the example of a Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullahu ta'ala, the people who said that Shaykh al-Albani is a muhaddith, he's a scholar of hadith, but he's not a scholar of fiqh. He said this very statement was reported by al-Imam al-Dhahabi from Ibn Aqil rahimahumullah, that it was said about al-Imam Ahmad. People said the same thing about al-Imam Ahmad. Imam Ahmad is a muhaddith, but he's not a faqih. He's not a scholar of fiqh, he's a scholar of hadith. And the Shaykh said this about Shaykh al-Albani is absolutely untrue. And recently there has been published a collection of fiqh opinions, rulings, and so on, so from the tapes that were made from a Shaykh al-Albani. And it reached 18 volumes of fiqh opinions from a Shaykh al-Albani. They took his tapes, they went through his tapes where he was giving answers to questions. And they found that the Shaykh had, they produced 18 printed volumes of the Shaykh's fiqh opinions. Shaykh Ali Hafidhahullah, he said all of it was fiqh and istinbat and nadhar. All of it is taking out rulings. And the, you know, the things that are classically associated with the faqih, like analogy and comparison and taking out rulings and what's a sunnah and what's a bid'ah and so on. The Shaykh said whether Shaykh al-Albani was correct in all of them or whether he was wrong in some of them, that's not, that doesn't concern us. It's not about how, what percentage he was right or wrong in. It doesn't, that's not what matters, because it's not what is we're talking about here. We're talking about whether he could be called a faqih, a scholar of fiqh. He said Shaykh al-Albani will have to answer to Allah for the rulings he gave, like every other scholar of fiqh will have to answer for the rulings that he gave, that Shaykh al-Albani is no different in that to any of the other scholars of fiqh. And it doesn't make any sense. The Shaykh said he's not fardu zamani, he's not the only person in his time who ever gave an opinion about anything, or the only person in his time who ever joined between fiqh and hadith. He's a person that is like other scholars from the scholars. An alim from the ulama, he made ijtihad, he made his opinion about what's right and what's wrong. He has tarjihat, things which he preferred over others, things which he said are right and other things which he said are wrong. And we may agree with him in some of them, or we may disagree with him in some of them, because the Shaykh said this is what knowledge is. This is what ilm is. It's ajar and ajaran. If you get one reward or you get two rewards, it's all about that. That's how all of the scholars ever, they're all like this. They say things, some we agree, some we disagree, some we take, some we don't. They have opinions, they have preferences, like every other scholar. And he said al-Imam Ahmad was just like this. The people, he said that Ibn Aqil, rahimahullah, he refuted this statement that al-Imam Ahmad was a scholar of hadith and not a scholar of fiqh. He said, look at the masail, look at the fiqh issues that are reported from him via his son. Look at the fiqh issues. Look at his students who became great scholars of fiqh. Imam Ahmad, among his students who became great scholars of fiqh, who learned from him. The Shaykh said, there's a difference, of course, in the level of knowledge, and there's a difference in the time in which Imam Ahmad lived and Shaykh al-Albani lived. We're not saying that those two are equal. But this is what fiqh is. Otherwise, what do you think that fiqh is? Like, what the people who say Shaykh al-Albani is not faqih, or the people before that who said Imam Ahmad is not faqih, we ask them the question, what do you actually think that fiqh is? Tell me, what is fiqh if it's not these things? And he said this is only a means to criticize the scholars. It started with Al-Imam Ahmed, and it keeps on going all the way down until Shaykh Al-Albani, rahimahullah ta'ala, with people keep on bringing this criticism. But Shaykh said, this criticism is a failure.
ومن باب التكميل والبيان أسوق كلمة للشيخ العلامة الشيخ محمد بن صالح العثيمين رحمه الله وعندي أعوذ بالله من شر نفسي وسيئات عملي عندي أن الشيخ بن عثيمين فقيه هذا الزمان فقيه العصر لا أعلم عالما في الفقه بموسوعية واطلاع الشيخ بن عثيمين الآن ما مقدار الصواب والخطأ قضية أخرى لأننا كما قلنا العلم خطأ وصواب وأجر وأجران واجتهاد لكن نتكلم عن الآلية وعن القاعدة الكلية والأصول العلمية التي يبنى عليها الفقه عند هذا العالم أو ذاك الشيخ بن عثيمين رحمه الله سئل عن الشيخ الألباني طبعا ليس كلامنا عن الشيخ الألباني لكن ذكرناه لأنه نموذج يتكرر الكلام عنه في هذا الزمان سواء من محبيه أو من مبغضيه من الذين يعدلون فيه أو ممن يظلمونه سئل عن الشيخ الألباني فقال الشيخ الألباني محدث وفقيه وإن كان محدثا أقوى منه فقيها طبعا هذا كلام صحيح الشيخ الألباني محدث أكثر من فقيه لكن هل كونه محدثا أكثر منه فقيها يمنعه أن يكون فقيها الجواب لا وأنا أعكس الصورة أقول الشيخ ابن عثيمين محدث وفقيه لكنه فقيه أكثر منه محدثا هل أحد يستطيع أن يعارضني في هذا القول لا أحد والشيخ ابن عثيمين نفسه يقول أنا في الحديث لست كفقه في الفقه أقوى والشيخ الألباني في الحديث أقوى لكن كلاهما محدث وفقيه هذه نقطة مهمة جدا تبين الخلل الطارئ عند من يفرقون بين الفقه والحديث حتى إن بعضهم قال كل محدث فقيه وليس كل فقيه محدث أو العكس كل هذا تنظيرات يعني تصورية غير مبنية على علم وإدراك ولا نستطيع أن نقول هذا العالم محدث وليس بفقيه وهذا العالم فقيه وليس محدث هكذا دون النظر والاستيعاب والدراسة والترجيح أما الأصل أن يكون كل محدث فقيها وأن يكون كل فقيه محدثا هذا الأصل قد يقع خلل وهذا أشرت إليه لكنني أعيده قد يقع خلل في هذه الأدوات أو في هذا الأصل فهذا الخلل لا يبطل القاعدة إنما يكون خللا واردا على هذا أو ذاك في علمهم وفي فقههم وفي درجتهم العلمية.
The Sheikh said in order to complete this statement, in order to just bring it to a close, he said, I'm going to quote to you from the great Sheikh and the amazing scholar, Sheikh Al-Allama Muhammad Salih Al-Uthaymeen. Rahimahullah, and he said, the Shaykh said, I seek refuge from the evil of myself and the evil of my actions. He said, I believe personally that Shaykh Al-Uthaymeen was the greatest scholar of fiqh of his time. And that there was nobody who reached such a level of encyclopedic knowledge and vast amount of reading like Shaykh Al-Uthaymeen. He said, we're not talking about how much he was right or wrong. We're just talking about his sheer ability to give out or to in the science of fiqh, his sheer ability in the science of fiqh. So Shaykh Al-Uthaymeen was asked about Shaykh Al-Albani. He said, well, we're not here to talk about Shaykh Al-Albani, rahimahullah. But this is just an example because there's so many people talk about Shaykh Al-Albani from those who love him, those who don't like him, those who are fair to him, those who oppress him. So he quoted from الشيخ ابن عثيمين that الشيخ الألباني was a محدث and he was a فقيه he was a scholar of hadith he was a scholar of fiqh but he was a scholar of hadith more than he was a scholar of fiqh that's what الشيخ ابن عثيمين said he was a scholar of hadith more than he was a scholar of fiqh And the Sheikh said, we don't have any objection to that. Any, like that he was both, but he was more of a scholar. He was more known for his hadith than he was known for his fiqh. Or he had more to say about hadith than he had to say about fiqh. And the Sheikh, he said, I say the opposite about Sheikh Ibn Taymin. That Sheikh Ibn Taymin was a scholar of fiqh and a scholar of hadith. But he was more a scholar of fiqh than a scholar of hadith. He had more statements about fiqh than he had statements about hadith. He said, is anyone going to oppose me in this? Is anyone going to say to me that Sheikh Ibn Taymin didn't have knowledge of hadith? He said he was a scholar of hadith, he was a scholar of fiqh. But he was more known for his fiqh than he was known for his hadith. And he said, Sheikh Ibn Taymin himself said that my knowledge of hadith is not the same as my knowledge of fiqh. They're not equal, not perfectly equal. So then the Sheikh, he said that this is to explain the flaw in this whole concept when these people say that every muhaddith faqih, every faqih is muhaddith, muhaddith is not faqih, faqih, and all of these different variations, that this isn't really based upon a proper investigation or a proper understanding. He said the basic principle and the rule is that a faqih should also be a muhaddith and a muhaddith should also be a faqih. However, we're not going to say that there aren't some flaws in people. There aren't one or two or, you know, some exceptions in that regard, and someone who has a flaw in their knowledge of hadith compared to their fiqh, or a flaw in their knowledge of fiqh compared to hadith. But he says this doesn't negate the principle that the scholar is the one who has both of those two things.
بقيت ثلاثة أسئلة لنكون أقرب إلى إتمام القول في هذا المجلس وفي هذه المحاضرة. السؤال الأول أن أهل الحديث يتهمون بالتقصير في أصول الفقه الذي كما قلنا هو من أهم العلوم المساعدة المنتجة للفقيه الصحيح والقادر على الفقه والاستنباط، وهذا غير صحيح من حيث التأصيل، من حيث التفريع ومن حيث الواقع. قد يوجد أهل الحديث في النهاية هم بشر، قد يقصر هذا أو يخطئ هذا. نحن لا نقول بأن أهل الحديث معصومون، وإن كنا نعتقد أن منهجهم هو الأقرب إلى الصواب والأدنى إلى الصحة. فأنا أقول إبطالا لهذا الزعم وجوابا على هذا السؤال، أول كتاب في علم أصول الفقه ألف في التاريخ هو كتاب الرسالة للإمام الشافعي، والإمام الشافعي عمدة أهل الحديث في زمانه، حتى إن أهل مكة لما ورد إليهم لقبوه بناصر الحديث، ناصر الحديث. وكم من مرة يقول إذا صح الحديث فهو مذهبي، فهو معظم للحديث. وكتابه في أصول الفقه الذي يبنى عليه الفقه وتفريعاته، هذا أولا. الأمر الثاني، في مرحلة أخرى لو نظرنا إلى كتاب قواطع الأدلة للإمام السمعاني نراه كله بناه على ترجيحات أهل الحديث. لو نظرنا في فوائد الأصول التي نثرها ونشرها شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية في كتبه نراها كلها قواعد أصولية تعظم الحديث وتبعد عن التعصب والتمذهب الذي يبنى على العصبية أيضا. إذن هذه دعوة فاشلة. أما من حيث الأشخاص قد يكون في النهاية كما قلنا وأكرر، أهل الحديث هم بشر من البشر. ولو نظرتم أيها الإخوة في كتاب صحيح البخاري لرأيتم أن تبويبات الإمام البخاري تدل على فقه واستنباط جميلين عزيزين، وهو عمدة أهل الحديث وكتابه عمدة كتب الحديث، وأقيمت دراسات على فقه الإمام البخاري في صحيحه، عشرات المجلدات والكتب والمؤلفات سواء دراسات أكاديمية أو دراسات علمية محضة. كذلك الإمام ابن خزيمة، ومما لا يعرفه كثير من الناس أن ابن خزيمة هو شيخ الإمام البخاري، والبخاري درس على ابن خزيمة وروى عنه، وإن كان لم يروي عنه في صحيحه، لم يروي عنه في صحيحه. إذا نظرتم إلى كتاب صحيح ابن خزيمة ترون فيه من الفقه ودقائق الاستنباط والنظر والمناقشة الشيء الكثير الكثير. فهذا سؤال وهذا جوابه ولله الحمد.
The Sheikh says there are three questions that remain in order for us to complete what we want to present to you in this sitting and in this lesson. He said the first is that Ahlul Hadith are criticized for having a deficiency in Usool al-Fiqh. Usool al-Fiqh being the science which deals with the fundamental principles and way of taking the rulings out of the Quran, the Sunnah. And the Sheikh, he said, this is not correct. From the point of view of the concept, the concept is not correct. He said, yes, Ahlul Hadith are human beings, and there may be people among Ahlul Hadith that have a deficiency in their understanding of Usul al-Fiqh. But as a concept, that Ahlul Hadith as a group of people are deficient in Usul al-Fiqh, this is something that is not correct. He said their manhaj, their methodology is the closest one to the truth. He said we don't deny that. But they're individual people. Some of them might have a deficiency in this. But as a whole, as a principle or a concept, can we say that Ahlul Hadith are deficient in the matter of Usul al-Fiqh? The Sheikh said, I'm going to respond. The first book to be written on Usul al-Fiqh is the book Ar-Risala by Al-Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, and he said Al-Imam al-Shafi'i was the scholar of Ahlul Hadith in his time. He was the one that everyone went back to for Hadith in his time, such that they gave him the nickname Nasir al-Hadith, the supporter of Hadith. He was known, he was the big reference point for Hadith in his time, and he was the first person to write a book about Usul al-Fiqh. Usul al-Fiqh, upon which Fiqh rulings are based. These are the principles and rules and science upon which Fiqh rulings are based. And the Sheikh, he mentioned also another book called Qawati'u al-Adilla by Sam'ani rahimahullah ta'ala. And the Sheikh also mentioned Fawaid Usul, which were both, he said this is something which Sheikh Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala spread and spoke about. He said this is full of, this is to do with Usul al-Fiqh, which are full of honoring the Hadith and venerating the Hadith and raising up the Hadith, and they don't have any of that blind sort of following or blind allegiance to a madhab in a way that is blameworthy. He says none of that in there. And then he said, I'm going to repeat again that Ahlul Hadith are human beings. They may have some mistakes. There may be individuals who didn't know as much about this as others. He said, I'm not going to say they're human beings. They might have mistakes. But what I'm going to say to you is that when you look at these, the Sheikh said, when you look at all these books, what you see is the veneration of Hadith within Usul, within those people who wrote about Usul al-Fiqh. And he mentioned how Imam al-Shafi'i being the first one to write on that topic. Then he said, if you look at the chapter headings in Sahih al-Bukhari, you see the fiqh, the knowledge and the istinbat, being able to take the rulings out from Al-Imam Al-Bukhari's Sahih. And Imam Al-Bukhari is who in terms of Hadith? He's their teacher, he's their sheikh when it comes to Hadith. He's the one everyone mentions when goes back to when it comes to Hadith. And yet his chapter titles contain so much fiqh and so much extraction of rulings and in terms of Usul fiqh, istinbat, how you take the rulings out from the Hadith. He said that there are academic studies. There are studies that have been published out of universities, studies that have come just ilmi, scholars writing about them themselves, in tens and tens and tens of books, just talking about Usul al-Fiqh and taking out rulings just from the chapter titles in Sahih al-Bukhari. And the Sheikh, he mentioned also, Imam Ibn Khuzaymah, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said many people don't know he was the Sheikh of Imam al-Bukhari. But al-Bukhari doesn't narrate from him in his Sahih. So al-Bukhari doesn't narrate a Hadith from him in Sahih al-Bukhari, but he was his teacher and Bukhari sat with him and learned from him and took Hadith from him. If you read the book Sahih Ibn Khuzaymah, you see the fiqh that he had, and the istinbat, his ability to take out rulings. Because remember, Usul al-Fiqh is all about taking out the rulings. how you take the rulings out. So how he could take out these rulings and how much fiqh he had, and yet he is again another scholar of hadith.
السؤال الثاني: هل دراسة كتب الفقه المذهبي تؤدي إلى التقليد؟ أنا أقول بالعكس، الأصل أنها تخرج عن التقليد، لأن المقلد هو الجاهل الذي لا يسعه إلا التقليد وهو غير قادر على التمييز والترجيح والنظر في الأدلة، فدراسته للفقه تخرجه عن هذا وترقيه إلى درجة الاتباع والنظر والقدرة على التمييز. لكن ما هو المذموم؟ المذموم هو التعصب، سواء كان من المقلد وهو الجاهل أو من المتبع أو حتى من العالم الذي هو غير مقلد، فالتعصب هو المذموم، ليس الدراسة المذهبية أو غير المذهبية هي المذمومة. لو أن أحدا درس الفقه على كتاب نيل الأوطار للشوكاني وتعصب له، هل فعله مقبول؟ فعله غير مقبول، لأن المذموم هو التعصب. لذلك أقوال العلماء في فهم النصوص هي وسيلة، والغاية هي تعظيم النص، فإذا قلبت الوسائل إلى غايات يكون التعصب ويكون التحزب ويكون الأمر المرفوض المذموم الذي لا نريده ونسعى إلى نقضه. أما التقليد فالتقليد إنما يسع الجاهل الذي لا يحسن النظر والترجيح، كما قلنا ذلك وأكدناه وكررناه وقررناه أكثر من مرة في هذه الأيام والمجالس المباركة.
The Sheikh said the second question: does the study of a madhab lead a person, or books of a madhab lead a person into taqlid?
كتب الفقه, books of fiqh.
The books of fiqh al-madhab. The books of a madhab, as in fiqh, the studying fiqh from the books of the madhab lead a person to taqlid. The Shaykh said, in fact, the opposite should be the case, because the person who does taqlid is the ignorant person who isn't able to look at the evidences, isn't able to distinguish the difference between what the scholar said, isn't able to prefer one scholar over another. That's the person who is allowed to make taqlid. And the idea is, when you study a madhab from the books of the madhab, the fiqh of the madhab, what's going to happen is you're going to come out from that. You're going to gain the ability to look at the evidences, to choose the difference between the scholars, to balance up their opinions. That's going to take you out of that. And the Shaykh said, what is blameworthy is the ta'assub, the fanaticism towards anything, even he said, to even if it comes, whether it comes from the muqallid, who is the one who is blind following, or whether it comes from the one who is balancing the opinions of the scholars out, or whether it comes from the alim who himself is mujtahid, he's given his own fatawa. If fanaticism comes from any of them, it is blameworthy. And the Shaykh, he said, dirasa madhabiyya, studying a madhab, it doesn't lead you to this. It shouldn't lead you to this. And the Shaykh said, for example, he gave another different example. He said, if someone studied Nail al-Awtar by al-Shawkani, and just so the brothers know, al-Shawkani generally doesn't follow a particular madhab. So this book is not one of the four madahib. It's a book that isn't صحيح نقول الشوكاني غير مقيد بمذهب شيخ.
طبعا
نعم حتى أشرح لهم لأنه ربما لا يعرفون.
أحسنت.
So I just checked with the Shaykh, that's true, that to say that الشوكاني did not used to follow one madhab. So someone takes الشوكاني's book, which doesn't follow one madhab, نيل الأوطار, and then he becomes متعصب, fanatical about that book. It's just as blameworthy as the person who becomes fanatical about a particular madhab. Sheikh said, because the statements of the scholars are a means to an end, and the means to an end is venerating and honoring and glorifying the text, the adilla, the nas, the hadith, the Quran, the sunnah. And as for when you make the means the end, you with me? When you make the means into the end, you make the statements of the scholars your final goal, and not the Quran and the sunnah your final goal. You make the statements of the scholars, this is what leads to fanaticism and partisanship, tahazzub, and all of these things. And Shaykh said in the beginning again, he said, as we repeat again and again, taqleed is something that is the blind following, that is when you follow without asking for evidence. You don't ask for evidence, just take the opinion like that straight away. This is for the ignorant person who isn't able to distinguish between what the scholars said. It's for the jahil. And the Shaykh said, how many times we have said, repeated it, we've established this, and we've said it in over these last few days. And he just repeat that point, that taqleed is only for the person who is ignorant to the level that they're not able to take any evidence.
السؤال الثالث يسأل البعض عن كتاب ألفه الحافظ بن رجب الحنبلي رحمه الله بعنوان وهو رسالة صغيرة الرد على من اتبع غير المذاهب الأربع فهل هذا فيه إيجاب تقليد المذاهب؟ أنا أقول هذا غير صحيح بل فيه قضية أخرى وهي عدم الخروج عن المذاهب قضية إيجاب تقليد المذاهب شيء وقضية الخروج عن المذاهب شيء آخر ولو أردنا أن ننظر إلى مسائل الفقه والصحة فيها لرأينا أن المذاهب الأربعة استحوذت على أكثر من 98% من الصواب في الفقه والاستنباط لو قلنا 100% لجعلناها معصومة وجعلناها كاملة وهذا غير صحيح ولا يتحقق لبشر هذه نقطة النقطة الثانية أن كلام ابن رجب من حيث هو ليس حجة على أحد هو كلام عالم يقبل منه ويرد عليه وليس كلام غيره من أهل العلم حجة عليه الحجة في الدليل وما يترجح من الدليل كلام الحافظ ابن رجب بالجملة صحيح لكن يؤخذ عليه أنه قد يفهم من كلامه أن الصواب محصور فقط في الأئمة في المذاهب الأربعة وهذا كما قلنا نسبته 98% أو 97% أو حتى 99% طب والباقي الباقي قد نأخذه من فقهاء آخرين مثل سفيان الثوري مثل ابن جرير مثل أبي ثور وعلماء من علماء متأخرين مثل ابن تيمية ومثل الإمام الذهبي وغيرهم من العلماء فنحن لسنا ضد التمذهب ولا ضد المذاهب الأربعة نحن مع تعظيم العلماء وتعظيم الفقهاء لكن كما قلنا ونقول وسنظل نقول تعظيمنا للدليل أقوى وأكثر وأهم
The Sheikh, he said the third question is regarding a book that was written by Hafidh ibn Rajab rahimahullah ta'ala And this book is definitely published in English because I've come across it before. And it's called Ar-Raddu 'ala man ittaba'a ghayra al-madhahib al-arba'a, The Refutation of the One Who Follows Other Than the Four Madahib, Something Other Than the Four Madahib. And this book is definitely available in English. So the Shaykh said this book, in reality, there are two separate things. And the issue of not going outside of the madhahib as a whole, i.e. not having an opinion that is held outside of all of the opinions that exist within the madhab, is a completely different issue. It's a different qadiyah completely. It's a totally different issue. So what Ibn Rajab is speaking about is that you don't, your opinion doesn't go outside of one of the opinions that exist within one of the madhahib. It's not about blindly following one madhab to the end, or that one madhab is correct and the other one is wrong, or you have to stay within one, you can't go to the other. Sheikh says, Qadiyat is totally different, two different issues. It's about the fact that in your opinion, you don't go outside of one of the many opinions that exist within that group, that pool of opinions in the madhab. So the Sheikh said, we're going to say that within the four madhahib, 98 or 99% of all of the correct answers are found within the four madhahib, somewhere. That's not within, so you understand the Shaykh, it's not within one madhab. Within the pool of opinions that exist within the four madhahib, 98, 99% of the correct opinions exist somewhere in those madhahib. Shaykh said, if we said 100%, then we have to say that the madhahib are ma'asuma, they're infallible, and there's no mistakes in them at all. He said, we can't say that. And he said, then we're going to say another point. The statement of Ibn Rajab, what Ibn Rajab wrote, is something which isn't an evidence in itself. It's a statement of a scholar. And everyone has their statements accepted, and sometimes we have criticism, we raise a criticism about their statements. And likewise, the statements of other people who said other things also is not a proof. So we can't use a proof, Ibn Rajab's statements on its own as a proof, and we can't use what other scholars said as a proof against Ibn Rajab, because in the first place, they're just statements of scholars. He said generally, as a whole, what Ibn Rajab said is correct. However, one criticism that we have is it may be understood from what Ibn Rajab said that the truth only exists within the opinions of the four madhahib. And the Shaykh said, even though we say 99% that's true, he said, in reality, we can't say 100% that there is no way there could ever be any opinion outside of those four. He said, we might take it from other scholars, like Sufyan, like Ibn Jarir, like Abi Thawr, like Ibn Taymiyyah from the later scholars, al-Dhahabi. We might take, you know, things from them that weren't originally in the four madahib, but this is extremely rare, because she has 99% of the time, you're going to be taking an opinion that exists within those four madahib somewhere. The Shaykh said, do not understand. We are not, he said, understand, we are not against a madhab, and we're not against following a madhab, or maybe we could say attributing yourself to madhab, to follow or to attribute yourself to a madhab. He said, we're not against that. We honor the statements of the scholars, but we honor the evidence more than we honor the statements of the scholar. We honor and respect the statements of our scholars, but we honor the evidence more, even more than that.
أختم أيها الإخوة الأحبة بالخلاصة فأقول منهج أهل الحديث في الفقه والاستنباط مبني على ثلاثة أمور. الأمر الأول احترام الأئمة والفقهاء جميعا وتقديرهم وإعطاؤهم منزلتهم. الأمر الثاني الأخذ منهم كلهم وعدم حصر أنفسهم في واحد. أنا عندي حديقة كبيرة فيها أطايب الطعام والشراب، أخذ من شجرة واحدة أو فاكهة واحدة وأترك البقية، هذا ظلم لي. وهكذا العلم، لكن العلم ليس بالتشهي، وهو النقطة الثالثة تعظيم النصوص وتقديمها، لكن ليس مستقلا عن فهم الفقهاء وترجيحاتهم وشروحاتهم، بل بحسب ما ورد إلينا من شروح العلماء وفقههم واستنباطهم وأقوالهم بما لا يسعنا الخروج عنهم. لذلك كان الإمام أحمد رحمه الله يقول إياك وكل مسألة ليس لك فيها إمام. وكان شيخنا الشيخ الألباني يردد هذا كثيرا، وفي هذا رد على من اتهم الشيخ الألباني بأنه يأخذ من النصوص دون الرجوع إلى أقوال العلم ومن عمل بهذه النصوص من العلماء. هذا غير صحيح، لا في الشيخ الألباني ولا في أهل الحديث من قبله وبعده. فالمنهج الحديثي لأهل الحديث مبني على هذه الأصول الراسخة، لكن من حيث التفريع هم بشر كالبشر، يخطئون ويصيبون، كما نقول أخطأ المذهب الحنفي في كذا، وأصاب الشافعي في كذا، وأخطأ أبو حنيفة في كذا، نقول أخطأ الألباني في كذا، وأخطأ ابن باز في كذا، وأخطأ ابن عثيمين في كذا، وأصاب فلان في كذا. هذا لا ليس فيه شيء من حرج على قلوبنا، وإن كانوا في خطئهم وفي صوابهم مأجورون أجمعين، كما قال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام: إذا اجتهد الحاكم وأصاب فله أجران، وإذا اجتهد وأخطأ فله أجر واحد. نتكلم عن العلماء، لا نتكلم عن الجهلاء، نتكلم عن الفقهاء، لا نتكلم عن المقلدين. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.
Tim, one second. Brother Sheikh Ali has to leave now.
So before the translation ends, inshallah, but he'll be back this evening to take questions and answers, inshallah.
جزاكم الله خيرا.